Welcome back to Literacy, and we are doing a fantastic job this week of working towards writing a story based on our own story map, based on that challenge by Cressida Cowell. And I've been so impressed with how you've been using your imaginations to create these imaginary storylines. You've also created a character, which I loved seeing those yesterday. So today what we're going to do is we're going to write the opening of your story, and in that story opening we're going to need to describe the place on your map where the story begins. We're going to need to describe your character and the main problem in the story. So you will need your story map, you will need a pencil and some paper, and then we are ready to go. Okay, good. So we're going to have a quick practice of our spellings before our interactive spelling test tomorrow. And I've just chosen 5 of the spellings today and I've spelt them incorrectly. I wonder if you can figure out what is wrong with these spellings and write them correctly. So pause the video and just write down these spellings as they should be. Good. How did you do? Okay, so the first one quickly. Now all of our spellings this week are adverbs with an ly suffix, adverbs of manner, how something is done. So I walked into the room quickly, but of course it's an ly adverb, isn't it? It's not ley. So the first one quickly, the change that we need to make is just ly on the end. The second one, gently, again it should be ly. Now although the word gentle ends in the E, of course when we write the adverb gently we do need to remove that E and it becomes gently, like that. Fantastic. Unexpectedly, and I mean I suppose if you say it you might think there's an A in there at the end, but they're all E's in this one, so it's unexpected. It's got TED in the middle. Unexpectedly. I thought that might be a little mistake that some people might just make inadvertently. Lovely. Right, curiously. Mm-hmm. Of course, the U is missing in this one. So we often have an us in a word. And in this word, curiously, curiously. So it was the U there that was missing. Fantastic. And then furiously, we have got the OUS, but it should be IOUS in furiously. So FOURIOUSLY. Now, one of our spelling words has got EOUSLY, EOUSLY. Can you remember which one? That's right, it's courteously, which means politely. So that doesn't quite fit on, especially that Y at the bottom. So those are spelling words and how they should be spelt. I think we're ready, everybody. But remember, you can practice on Spelling Shed and we'll be ready for that at 11:30 tomorrow. Okay, everybody. So as a quick start today, we're going to practice writing a fantastic sentence to describe our characters. And I'm going to show you how you can do that by describing Zar from the Witches of the Wizards of Once. Okay, so we've got a really simple sentence there. Zar was a humble boy, using the adjective humble to describe him. And of course, we need to think whether or not an adjective is suitable for our character. Do you think that Zar is humble from what you learned about him yesterday? I don't really think so. I mean, somebody is humble, is very modest and doesn't show off at all. So I'm not sure that that's Zar. So I need to change my adjectives, but I'm also going to add another adjective in. So I've got adjective, adjective, noun. So that means that I've written an expanded noun phrase. So let's change that this time. So it says Zar was a skinny. There's my first adjective. And then a comma. Then disobedient, remember he doesn't do as he's told. And then the noun, boy. And you could write scruff of a boy like Cressida Cowell did. I really liked that. Czar was a skinny, disobedient boy. So I've written an expanded noun phrase with two adjectives before my noun. But I'm not going to leave it there. I'm going to add some more details, extra details. And one way you could do that was to start with the word with and write a prepositional phrase. Tell me something about him, something he's got. It could be his hair, could be his weapon, his sword, or I'm going to write about his eyes. So, Czar was a skinny, disobedient boy with a cheeky glint in his eye. So I'm finding out more about his personality as well as his appearance. So there we go. That's already a pretty good sentence, isn't it? Czar was a skinny, disobedient boy with a cheeky glint in his eye. And I could leave it there, I could put a full stop and then move on to the next sentence. But I'm going to push it a little bit more and add one more part to the sentence. And I'm going to use this time a relative clause with the word who. Here we go. Who, and I remember that he really wanted his magic powers to arrive. So I'm going to put who longed to become a real wizard. There we go. So we've actually got lots of information all in one sentence. Let's read it back. Czar was a skinny, disobedient boy with a cheeky glint in his eye who longed to become a real wizard. Going to separate that phrase off there with some commas just so that I know that that's a little extra bit. And you notice how I kept reading back through my sentence just to make sure it's making sense. Czar was a skinny, disobedient boy with a cheeky glint in his eye who longed to become a real wizard. So we started off by having an expanded noun phrase with two adjectives, and then we used with to add something that he had, something about him, an extra detail, and then we used who to tell me again a relative clause, something else about him. So that is what I'd like you to do now with your character that you made up yesterday. So I would like you to describe your character that you made up yourself yesterday using that same model. I've included lots of adjectives here to describe different aspects of your character. Not all of that list will be appropriate to a character, but many of them are. So I've got an example here to show you that's not Czar. This is a character that I've made up called Fox. And again, I've started off with an expanded noun phrase with two adjectives. So Fox was a friendly 10-year-old boy. There we go. I've got my two adjectives there. I wonder which two adjectives that you would write to describe your character. So maybe pause the video here and write down what your character's name is and then an expanded noun phrase. Okay, and then my next part of my sentence using with. So I've told you something else that he's got, something about him and about his clothes, actually. But again, his clothes tell us about him, really, as well. So with tatty shorts and a faded blue jacket. Just tell me something about him. So maybe think, stop the video now and think what you could write about your character using with. Okay, and you can start the video when you're ready again. And read back your sentence so far. So far I've got Fox was a friendly 10-year-old boy, comma, with tatty shorts and a faded blue jacket, comma. And I'm now going to add my last part of my sentence, who loved exploring the mystical forests near his home. So I'm telling you something else about what he loves. So I wonder again if you can stop the video and use who to add something else about your character using who. So pause the video and then start again when you think you've got your sentence. Fantastic, everybody. So you should be able to read back through your whole sentence now. Here's mine. Fox was a friendly 10-year-old boy with tatty shorts and a faded blue jacket. who loved exploring the mystical forest near his home. So pause the video and read yours. Excellent, everybody, well done. And just to show you that it works just as well for monsters and baddies, I've got a completely different sentence here, a different character I just made up, but with the same format that works so well. So I think it's something we can definitely use in our story opener. So I've got Bard was an enormous, obnoxious ogre. So again, I've got those adjective, comma, adjective, noun. Obnoxious, really horrible, mean, cruel, obnoxious, disgusting. Okay. With green, warty skin. So again, I've got extra details using with. With green, warty skin and yellow, crooked teeth. Blech. And then finally, who hated the sound of children's laughter. So there's a completely different example, but the same sort of structure, as you can see. So try and hang on to that one for our story opener. Brilliant. So we're ready to start on our story opener. And the first thing that we need to think about is where our story is going to start. Where on the map does it actually begin? So here are a selection of your story maps from the other day. And so you've each got your own one and I've got mine as well. So we all need to think where the story is going to start, where our character will be at the beginning of the story. And that could be anywhere on your map, dependent on what you think your character is maybe doing, what time of day it is. So the key things that we're going to need in our story opener are, we're going to need to know about the setting, where the story starts and when and what sort of time is it? When is this story taking place? What time of day maybe, or time in history, long, long ago, etc. We're going to need to introduce our character. We're going to need to explain why our character is there and that place on the map and what they are doing. And we're also going to need to explain what the problem is in our story. What challenge is our character going to face in the story? So those are the four things that we're going to need to think about. So we know the four things that need to be in our story opener, but they don't actually have to come in that order. So I thought we'd have a little look at how the opening of Wizards of Once, how Cressida Cowell introduced those four things in the story opener. So as we go read through the beginning part of the story, see if you can keep track of where she's talking about setting, introducing Czar, explaining why Czar is where he is, and then introducing the problem in the story. So here we go. It was a warm night for November, too warm a night for witches, or so the story said. Witches were supposed to be extinct, of course, but Czar had heard about the way they stank. And he imagined he could smell that now in the quietness of the dark forest. A faint but definite stink of burning hair mixed with long dead mice and a little kick of viper's venom. One smelled, never forgotten. So already in this part here, we know when it is. It's a warm night in November. And we know that we're in that forest, the quietness of the dark forest. And we've also introduced Czar, although we know nothing about him yet. We know that he is looking for witches. We know why he's there. Witches, we have a bit of the context. We know that witches are supposed to be extinct, but he knows what they smell like. And he thinks that he can smell them there that night. So we know the problem as well that Czar's got to face, and which is that he's looking for witches. Okay, so let's continue. This bit we know from yesterday. Czar, pronounced Czar, I don't know why, spelling is weird, was a wild young human boy who belonged to the wizard tribe. Do you notice those different features of the character description that we just practiced? We've got the wild young human boy, that expanded noun phrase, and then we've got a relative clause starting with who. He was riding on the back of a giant snowcat in a part of the forest so dark and mangled and tangled that it was known as the Bad Woods. I love those adjectives, mangled and tangled, that rhyme, that actually really make this Bad Woods sound so horrible, so really bad. So we've got a description of the setting and where they are again, as well as finding out more about the character. So you can see how Cressida Cowell is fitting these four things together, but not necessarily just all in that order. Jumbles them up a bit. He should not have been there, for the Badwoods were warrior territory, and if the warriors were to catch him, well, what everyone said, that was Tsar would be killed on sight, off with his head, as was the pleasant warrior custom. But Tsar did not look even remotely worried. Here we are, we're finding out more about him and his personality now, aren't we? He was a cheerful scruff of a boy with a tremendous quiff of hair shooting upwards from his forehead as if it had accidentally come into contact with some invisible vertical hurricane. The snow cat he was riding was called King Cat, a noble creature which was a giant form of lynx, far too dignified for his cheeky master. King Cat had shining paws, so round they looked unreal, fur so deep it was like powder snow, and such a rich silver grey colour that it was almost blue. So we've actually got a description of another very important character, a second character. The snow cat ran swiftly but softly through the forest, his black tipped ears swivelling from side to side as he ran, for he was scared, although too proud to show it. I think he's sensible, do you? I think he's wise to be scared where he is. Only that morning, Tsar's father, Encanzo the Enchanter, King of Wizards, had reminded everyone that it was forbidden for any wizard to dare set one toe in the Bad Woods. Here we know, there's a problem. So again, we're getting more about this problem. Tsar is in the woods looking for witches where he's not supposed to go, and his father, who is the King of the Wizards, has forbidden it. He said it's not allowed. But Tsar was the most disobedient boy in the Wizard Kingdom in about four generations, and forbidding things only encouraged him. I thought you'd like to find out a little bit about the kind of things that Tsar actually gets up to generally, because he's so disobedient. And that's something that you could do as well. You could say the kind of things that your character generally does. Okay, so in the past week, Tsar had tied the beards of two of the eldest and most respectable wizards together when they were sleeping at a banquet. Cheeky. He had poured a love potion into the pig's feeding trough, so the pigs developed mad passionate crushes on Tsar's least favourite teacher, oh my goodness, and followed him around wherever he went, making loud, enthusiastic squealing and kissing noises. Ridiculous. And he had accidentally burned down the western trees in the wizard camp. Most of these things, Tsar hadn't been entirely intentional. That means he didn't exactly mean to do it. Tsar just got carried away in the heat of the moment. And yet none of these disobedient things was half as bad as what Tsar was doing right now. So my goodness. Tsar is in the woods, he's looking for witches, he's not supposed to be there. His wise companion tells him he shouldn't be there, knows that he shouldn't be there as well, but that's where he is. So everybody, you need to decide where on your map your story is going to start, where your character is at the start of the story. You need to think about why they're there and what they're doing, and we need to introduce the problem as well as describing our character. So we've got just four things to do and just piece them together into our story opener. Now this was my map that I hurriedly did the other day, and it's not anywhere near as good as your ones that you've done, but I did draw a village, and I've decided I'm going to use the character that I wrote about earlier, Fox, that friendly boy, and he's left the village where he lives, and he's sort of outside exploring a little bit. Maybe he's think he's doing a job, but he likes going in the mystical forest, you remember. But I think when he gets there, there's going to be a problem. Okay, so I've decided that I'm starting the story about here, and then he's going to just sort of move into this mystical forest as well, where he's going to find his problem. So I'm going to start having a write of my story opener, because then hopefully that will help you too. So I need to say where and when the story is starting, and where Fox is, my character. So I'm going to start with a time phrase. As the afternoon wore on, decided he's out. He's been out quite a while. As the afternoon wore on, comma. So that's my fronted adverbial. Fox, road, further away from the village. So Fox Road, further away from the village where he lives. And the village, I've given it a name. It didn't have a name before, but I'm giving it a name. From Danglewood Village. Where he lived. So I've started by saying when it is and where he is. And also he's riding. He's not riding his bike because I've decided it's not that kind of story. He's riding a horse. We'll come to that in a bit. As the afternoon wore on, Fox Road, further away from Danglewood Village, where he lived with his parents and three younger siblings. I think he's out doing a job and he's kind of got quite a bit of responsibility. But he also likes a good game, as you will see. So I'm going to continue and I've been typing up what I have been writing. But just to show you, there's my piece of paper that I was working on to start with. And I don't know if you can make out, but I had to do quite a lot of editing and I did lots of changing and a little bit of crossing out quite neatly and then just adding different adjectives and so on just to keep working on it. But what I've got, which I'll show you in a moment, is hopefully going to show you a good story opener, which has got our four ingredients in it. There we go. So a bit quicker than me writing it all out in front of you. So as the warm afternoon wore on, Fox rode further away from Danglewood Village, where he lived with his parents and three younger siblings. His trusty horse still had a spring in her step. Okay, so the horse is feeling okay. But Fox was growing tired of looking for hazelberries for tea. Told you he had a job to do. He's got responsibilities as this boy. If he took a trip into the nearby mystical forest, he would feel some relief from the hot sun in the dappled, dreamy glades. And he might even be able to play with his friend Twig, one of the wood sprites. So I've just told you something about Fox and that he's got a friend called Twig, who is a wood sprite, but like a fairy. And then this is my sentence from earlier. You're describing my character because I need to explain him. I need to describe him now. Fox was a friendly 10-year-old lad with tatty shorts and a faded blue jacket who loved exploring the mystical forest near his home. Bit more about him. Son of the village baker, he was kind. He was a kind, skinny redhead who everyone loved because of his generous nature. Yes, his scruffy hair was as messy as a bird's nest, but nothing was ever too much trouble for Fox, and his smile spread warmth like a sunny day. I'm even getting some similes in there. And we know quite a lot about Fox now. I've introduced my character quite well. Also said where he is, why he's there and what he's doing. So the only thing that I now need to do is to introduce the problem in my story. But as Fox entered the normally playful forest, he felt instantly that something was wrong. Confused, he glanced quickly around for Twig, who should have been busily shooting in and out of the tree branches, gathering twigs for the wood sprite treehouse. But he was nowhere to be seen. Instead, a cold shiver ran down Fox's spine as he dismounted from his horse and stepped into a dark cloud of freezing mist that hung as far as he could see. Worried, Fox called out for his friend. What had happened in the mystical forest? So there you go. I've introduced the forest, the problem in the story. And also we've moved into the mystical forest as well. So that is my example to you. It had those four ingredients in it, kind of jumbled around a little bit. Don't have to go in order. I mean, they could, I guess. But those are the four things that you definitely need to get into your story opener. So over to you, everyone. I would like you now to think about the four things that you need in your story opening. You need to know where you are on your map when you start the story, where your character is, on the map, when the story starts, and when is it as well. You need to introduce your character, and you could use the sentence that you wrote earlier from in the lesson to help you with that, to get you started. You need to explain why they're there. Remember, Fox was looking for hazel berries and he got a bit warm, so we went into the mystical forest. What they're doing, and you need to introduce the problem in your story. And I know that many of you have got an idea what the problem is, so that just needs to be introduced to your reader. Fabulous. So there will be no new literacy lesson video for you tomorrow. This video and this task is for you to work on today and to continue tomorrow if you need to. And then of course we've got our spelling interactive spelling test at 11:30. So we don't need to worry about a new video tomorrow, but it would be great if you can all have a really good go at writing your story opener with those four things that we have discussed. Good luck, everybody. I am really excited to hear what you come up with. So good luck, everybody. I am going to leave you with that fantastic word bank that you saw earlier on your screen, as well as the four things to include in your story opener. If you'd like to pause the video while you do your work, then you'll have those clues and that vocabulary right there. Or you might want to rewind the video to pick up certain ideas that we had earlier in the lesson. But good luck. Over to you. Time.